most numerous of all the Navy ships of the line are its destroyers. These vessels are totally unarmored, but with their 5-inch dual-purpose main batteries, their anti-aircraft defenses, their torpedo tubes and depth charges, they pack more destructive power per ton than any warship afloat. Because they can attain a speed of about 40 knots, 44 land miles an hour, and can range 6,000 or more miles without refueling, they are adapted to widely varied activities. With the fleet, they are used as scouts, as an anti-submarine screen, or to launch torpedo attacks against the enemy. They are called upon, too, to act as convoy escorts and to protect all larger types of ships from submarines. Familiarly and affectionately known throughout the Navy as the Tin Cans, destroyers carry a crew of about 200 men. These ships are named for the Navy's distinguished dead, like John Paul Jones, Farragut and Dewey, Mahan and Sims. Indispensable to the protection of the battle line, and a new and necessary factor in any naval offensive, are aircraft carriers. Huge floating airports, whose hangars and flight decks can accommodate almost 100 combat planes of various types. Flight operations and ship control are centered in a so-called island, the carrier's superstructure. Though equipped with batteries for defense against attack, either from light surface craft or from the air, the aircraft carrier relies heavily upon the protection afforded by her own squadrons of fighter planes. These great new ships, whose crews number about 2,000 officers and men, are nicknamed the covered wagon. They bear names old and illustrious in U.S. history, names of early battles like Lexington, Saratoga, and Yorktown. Names of famous ships like Ranger, Enterprise, and the immortal Bonham Richard. Smallest and most compact of all seagoing warcraft, the submarine is the guerrilla fighter of the Navy, whose effectiveness lies in its ability to launch surprise torpedo attacks. The size of the submarine crew varies from less than 40 to more than 60, depending upon the type of the submarine. Some are relatively small craft with a short cruising radius. Others, the fleet submarines, are huge vessels, able to cruise great distances and remain at sea for weeks at a time. Called the pig boats, submarines are named for deep sea fish, like the stingray and swordfish, grampus, whale, and porpoise. With the United States beset by enemies on all the seas of the world, the eventual success of Allied strategy may well depend upon U.S. ability to keep open the vital waterways and supply lines between the Western Hemisphere and the distant theaters of war. Today, the U.S. Navy is realizing in full on the long-range planning and foresight of other generations who, a half a century ago, saw the need for a shortcut between America's two great oceans and built the Panama Canal. For example, today, if a division of first-line battleships operating in the Atlantic is needed in the Pacific, 8,000 miles and a whole month of precious time is saved by the 8-hour transit of the Panama Canal, whose locks are wide enough to permit the passage of the largest man of war. Panama's locks are also wide enough to accommodate the mighty bulk of the battle fleet's giant bodyguards, the ever-present aircraft carriers. Only when seen in close relationship to things on shore is it possible to grasp the vast proportions of this newest of naval warcraft. At sea in time of war, Its scores of planes are spotted on the flight deck, ready to take off at a moment's notice. The carrier passing through the canal seems a ponderous and peaceful craft. But concealed beneath its quiet decks are tons of high explosives, armor-piercing bombs for her VSBs, scout bombers, torpedoes weighing a ton for her VTBs, deadly torpedo bombers. Confined to a narrow channel, the carrier is out of its natural element, the open sea. For more than any other ships, the covered wagons demand unlimited sea room to maneuver freely at high speed. A call to battle stations transforms an aircraft carrier with startling suddenness. Within seconds, the ship's organization is functioning with perfectly calculated speed and precision. Captain, pilots, and aviation mechanics, all hands know exactly what to do. In the battle formation may be many types of planes and ships, each assigned to do the job best suited to it. On the surface, destroyers in advanced positions for screening and scouting. Far in the rear, ships of the train, the invaluable services of supply and repair. To protect the main battle line from submarine and air attack, our cruiser division, fast and powerful in assault. Aircraft carriers well behind, but within easy air range, to ensure command of the air, to launch aerial offensives. Finally, floating fortresses of enormous offensive power, the battleships. In battle comes the supreme test of organization, the complex relationship between men and materiel, upon which depends the fighting effectiveness of every navy. When fighting units of the fleet stand out to sea on battle missions, they are fulfilling the one purpose for which the Navy was conceived and built, for which the whole organization exists, for which every officer and blue jacket has been training from the day he joined the service. In battle, too, is finally tested the strength and worth of material, of iron and steel, of armor plate and ordnance, of boilers and turbines, of all the great mechanisms devised by man's ingenuity and scientific knowledge. And inevitably, the day is coming when the massed striking force of the United States Navy, its ships, its planes, and its men, will participate in the final reckoning, when the combined navies of the Axis enemy, driven into the open, are joined in battle to be finally destroyed.